St. Paul writes regarding the Lord's Supper, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? These words remind us, first and foremost, of our communion and fellowship with Christ. But this communion with Christ also results in another fellowship, a fellowship with those who we commune with. This is reflected in St. Paul's words to the Corinthians, because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we are all partake of the one bread. Finally, in this holy meal, we also have fellowship with the whole company of heaven. Besides the chief spiritual benefits of forgiveness, life, and salvation, the recipients of this holy gift also enjoy the comfort of being surrounded by a great company of witnesses, including those that love our loved ones who have departed in faith. We begin tonight in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And let us begin with our first lesson. Those who heard Peter preaching on Pentecost were witnessing God's power in action. In our first lesson, they spoke through the spoken word, through baptism and the spiritual changes, led people to repentance and faith and giving them the power to live lives of Christian love. Our first lesson is from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. And awe came from every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings, and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, they attended the temple together, the breaking of bread in their homes. They received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Here endeth our first reading. As two of Jesus' followers trudged gloomily along the road to the town of Emmaus on Easter Sunday evening, Jesus joins them along the way. Cast down in spirit, the two men find hope and understanding as Jesus, unrecognized to them, opens Scripture and reprimands them for their failure to listen and believe. As Jesus breaks bread with them at supper time, they suddenly recognize him and rejoice in the news of his resurrection. The Holy Gospel is written in Luke chapter 24, verses 28 through 35. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. Jesus acted as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed, broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were open, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sights. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the Scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how they had known him by the breaking of bread. This is the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. One of the manifold blessings of the Lord's Supper is the union that we have with Christ, with one another, and with the whole company of heaven. This blessed communion is made possible by the fact that Christ gives us his body and blood under the bread and wine for us Christians to eat and drink. It is not an imaginary union, but a true fellowship with Christ and with one another. The sermon for tonight highlights this blessed communion and the comfort that Christians may derive from it. Our text for this evening is written in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 14 to 22, where Paul tells us about proclaiming the gospel message, that it has power, an energy source for our Christian living, that also commends the congregation for their deeds of love, reminds them inward and outward change comes only through hearing the gospel. We read, "Therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to you as to sensible people. Judge for yourself what I am saying. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a communion with the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a communion with the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of one bread. Consider the children of Israel. Those who ate the sacrifices are partners of the altar, aren't they? So what am I saying? That the food from idols sacrifices anything? Or that an idol is anything? No, but I do say this, what the Gentiles sacrificed, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to become partakers of demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and in the union of demons. Or are we trying to provoke our Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he is? O Lord, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. Amen." Dear Lenten worshipers, during our Lenten season, we have been focusing on our meditation on sanctified gifts of the Lord's body and blood. The Lord's Supper is a life-giving fruit, giving eternal life to the one who eats it in faith. It is a bread from heaven, nourishing and strengthening the new man for his journey towards the heavenly promised land. It is a healing balm or medicine for the soul, an extension of Jesus' ministry of healing into the here and now. Tonight, then, we continue our meditation upon the benefits of the Lord's Supper, focusing our attention on the communion that we enjoy in this holy meal. Luther's communion hymn, "O Lord, We Praise Thee," confesses this truth in the third stanza. May God bestow on us his grace and favor, that we follow Christ our Savior, and live together here in love and union, nor despise this blessed communion. O Lord, have mercy. Luther's hymn, along with scripture readings tonight, remind us of the Lord's Supper, that it is a communion or participation with Christ with one another. Here, once again, are the words of St. Paul from 1 Corinthians. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? The Greek word Paul uses here is koinonia. It is translated in different ways into English. Usually, it is translated as fellowship or participation, or even communion. St. Paul is teaching the Christians in Corinth that through the Lord's Supper, we have union and fellowship with the body and blood of Christ. It is the same word used in the book of Acts chapter 2, verse 42, where the first Christians were described as devoting themselves steadfastly to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. This tells us quite plainly what these early Christians were doing. They were celebrating Holy Communion. They were celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. What a blessed gift this is. For through the means of bread and wine, Christians come into contact with the very Son of God himself. We have union with Christ in a way that we do not have anywhere else in the world. For the one who believes the words of Christ, this is a very good thing. Christ, the Holy One of God, shares his holiness with those who commune. This is especially a good thing because in and of ourselves we are not holy. So with repentant hearts, we confess that we are unholy and unclean sinners. By our fellowship with Adam and his unholy nature, we ourselves are made unholy. So our unclean thoughts, words, and actions make us unacceptable in God's sight. Jesus identifies the source of this unholiness in Matthew chapter 15, verse 19, when he says, "Out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murders, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander." So it should cause us great joy to hear that we, the unholy people, can share in Christ's holiness through participation in his holy things, namely his body and blood in the sacrament. Here, at the altar, he invites us to enjoy this blessed communion with him. But there's another dimension to this idea of communion or fellowship. There is another union that takes place for us in the Lord's Supper. It is first and foremost the union of a believer with Christ. This blessed communion results in another union, that of Christian to Christian. Our readings tonight also remind us that the Lord's Supper is never merely a me and Jesus thing, though we receive the benefits of the Lord's Supper individually. It is never a private matter. For when you come to the Lord's altar and receive this salutary gift given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins, you are also bound and united with those to whom you commune. And this is why our synod and congregations practice close communion. Those who commune are united in the same doctrine and fellowship, this biblical concept that has been practiced by the Christian church since the time of the apostles. So St. Paul says as much in the next part of his letter to the Corinthians, verse 17. "Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of one bread." We who are many, St. Paul says, become one body in the Lord's Supper. And since you are united with Christ and through him with another, it goes without saying that we should be united in our confession and faith and be reconciling with one another. Divisions at the Lord's table is not pleasing to the Lord. And if you claim to be reconciled with Christ, yet continue to hold on to a grudge and anger towards your fellow Christian brothers and sisters, are you not lying to the Lord? But there's another aspect of Holy Communion with Christ and with that we must talk about. It is that as we speak about this, we think of the Lord's Supper as a meal. Have you ever paid close attention to the words of the common liturgy? "Therefore, with archangels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying." These words remind us that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, as Hebrews 12:1 says, when we are gathered at the Lord's altar. Your departed loved ones who have fallen asleep with Jesus are part of this whole company of heaven. There are among those who have joined the church triumphant and are with Christ. In the Lord's Supper, we have fellowship not only with Christ and with one another, but also with these unseen saints. What comfort here there is in knowing that we have union with our Lord Jesus Christ and with that whole company of heaven. That was one of the symbols of the half-round communion rail in the Lutheran Church. Christ's body and blood are present at the altar. We believers in Christ gather at the rail to receive the whole body, his body and blood in the bread and wine. While Christ is still in heaven, the other half of the unseen rail with our loved ones who have died in the faith. This then is the closest that you can be to your loved ones that are in heaven. In this blessed communion of Christ's body and blood, our Lord answers a need that all Christians share. It is a need for fellowship with God and with one another. Nowhere does this happen in the same way as it does at the Lord's altar, where Christians are joined to Christ through his body and blood, where we who are many are made one body with Christ. May we never despise this blessed communion as we rejoice in it. Amen. And let us pray. O Lord God, you have left unto us this wonderful sacrament, a memorial of your passion. Grant, we beseech thee, that we may use this sacrament of your body and blood, that the fruit of your redemption may continually be manifested in us. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We join in the prayer of the church. Lord Jesus, as we turn our attention to your cross, we see the suffering you endured. You became human like us and came to take our place and endure our punishment as our substitute. We deserved your pain and anguish, but you endured it. Move our hearts to see your deep love for us unworthy sinners, and by your cross and suffering, fill us with gratitude for such an undeserved gift. Then fill us with joy and hope, because you have gained salvation for us. For the sake of your suffering and death, we pray this all in the prayer you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.